CRISPR Therapeutics stock is the topic of today's presentation. If you're somebody that's invested in CRSP stock, then you'll want to watch this because we look at an important upcoming milestone for the company. Now, we've written about gene editing extensively over the years. I don't believe we've ever taken a single look at CRISPR stock. We've always looked at it in the context of all the other gene editing stocks out there, of which there are quite a few. Now, CRISPR Therapeutics is notable because the founder, Emmanuelle Charpentier, the woman you see here, is known for her Nobel Prize-winning work in the area of CRISPR-Cas9, and two companies that she founded. One was ERS Genomics, and this is an interesting little entity that it says here, the global CRISPR-Cas9 licensing leader, and that's of interest to the people that want to examine the intellectual property battle that's happening. We'll talk about that in a second. But the other company she founded, of course, CRISPR Therapeutics, and they appear to be on the cusp of having the first approved gene editing therapy. Now, this ERS entity, it says here, licenses the CVC. That's an important acronym because in the context of intellectual property, you're going to see that thrown around a lot. It stands for University of California, University of Vienna, and Emmanuelle Charpentier. And that's the portfolio of patents that these entities represent. And their opponent, if you will, is the Broad Institute. And that was the notable IP battle that was going on. And right now, that seems to favor Broad Institute, though they've appealed the decision. Now, when you go to the news section of this ERS Genomics site, they provide a fair amount of interesting information about intellectual property, and they make the statement here, if you are based in the U.S. and using CRISPR-Cas9, you need a CVC license. They're saying that you need to license their something from their portfolio of patents, it says here. You may also need a license from the Broad Institute if you work specifically in eukaryotic cells, but you'll definitely need one from CVC to start with. So it doesn't appear to be a winner-takes-all situation. The other thing that needs to be considered here is the global IP position, and this is on the CRISPR Therapeutics investor deck. You can see here they're talking about their broad portfolio of 55 patents in the United States, and then their European and global patent portfolio. And I think something that often comes up here in regards to the battle between Broad Institute and CVC would be whether or not Editas stands to benefit from all this. And I guess we're going to find out pretty soon if Editas is going to get royalties from CRISPR Therapeutics. If you're interested in reading more about this, there's an extensive article here I've highlighted. It's titled CVC Appeals PTAB Decision and CRISPR Interference. It's rather verbose, but if you're interested in the technical details, then that's somewhere that you can look. Now, what we want to talk more about today would be the therapy Exa-cel, and this slide here says it all. After one dose of the CRISPR-Cas9 gene-edited therapy Exa-cel, 95% of patients with transfusion-dependent beta thalassemia became transfusion-free. So the idea here is that people with beta thalassemia or sickle cell disease need to go to the hospital all the time and have transfusions, and they can't do anything because they're always tied down to that hospital. Well, this is essentially a cure, and it is rather remarkable when you read about the 80 patients that CRISPR Therapeutics has been working with, and you know, some of those patients have upwards of 3 years of data that you can look at post-therapy to see that it's essentially cured them. And when we look at the addressable market for Exa-cel, so that's CRISPR Therapeutics therapy that's in the spotlight right now, is potentially the first gene-edited therapy to be made available. You can see here the total addressable market there along the top, sickle cell disease at 25,000 people, and then beta thalassemia at 7,000. Mainly we're going to talk about the sickle cell disease opportunity. You can see how they can expand this using something called targeted conditioning, which my understanding is that before you administer this gene therapy, you need to administer chemotherapy, and this would be a substitute for that, more effective. And then changing the delivery mechanism also is said to expand their addressable market. But for now, we're just interested in them capturing the immediate addressable market. And when you look at the company they're working with, so it's Vertex, initially they were going to share, that's CRISPR Therapeutics and Vertex, were to share all research and development costs and worldwide revenues. So they're in it together equally. But in 2021, they revised that. And it said here, Vertex leads and has all decision-making in relation to the Exa-cel program prospectively. So they've taken more of a leadership role there and in supposed to be compensated for that now. 60% of the revenues and costs are assigned there to Vertex, 40% to CRISPR Therapeutics. Now, I'm going to introduce another gene therapy here. And the reason for that is that this Institute for Clinical and Economic Review, ICER, they're this nonprofit research institute that produces reports analyzing evidence on the effectiveness and value of drugs and such. Well, they released this final evidence report that assesses the clinical effectiveness and value of two therapies, all right? So there's Exa-cel from CRISPR Therapeutics, we know about that, but also this lovo-cel from Bluebird Bio. That name may sound familiar to you. They're a company that's been around for quite a while, dabbling in gene therapies. And this report said that both these therapies demonstrate a net health benefit when compared to standard of care. That's what they have today to care for sickle cell disease. So both of these have a net benefit, but the current evidence is not adequate to distinguish the net health benefit between Exa-cel and lovo-cel. Why is that important? Because these two therapies are going to be made available at roughly the same time, provided that they're approved. They'll be made available at the same time such that patients will have to choose between those two. So essentially, this is a competing therapy for CRISPR Therapeutics. And this report also said looks like there's going to be about 25,000 people living with severe sickle cell disease in the U.S. that that these therapies will target. And they said that a health benefit price benchmark for either of these therapies would be anywhere between $1.35 million to $2.05 million. So now we're having an actual price that we can assign to the total addressable market so we could start to calculate some value. You may think that price tag is high, but when you look at, you know, millions of dollars that it takes to sustain these patients using the current standard of care, then it's actually quite the deal. Now, when it comes to profits in pockets, this report said that they would assume 20% of these people would initiate treatment in each of the next 5 years, or 2,500 people per year per gene therapy. So you have about 416 patients treated per month, 14 people a day. At midpoint pricing of $1.7 million, there's a potential here for $42.5 billion in revenues. But we need to remember a couple things. First of all, not all 25,000 people will opt for this treatment. Of those who do, a certain percentage will choose Exa-cel over lovo-cel, provided both therapies are approved and available. But what you need to remember here is when you look at Bluebird Bio, that's a $372 million company that's the underdog here. They seem to be barely surviving, while Vertex is a $97 billion company with nearly $9 billion in 2022 revenues. They have the experience and the $11 billion in cash to be able to make the Exa-cel therapy a success. When you look at Bluebird Bio's latest deck here, it shows how they expect their cash runway, that is if they use the restricted cash on their books, to last them through the fourth quarter of next year. And they have these other therapies they're trying to launch here that have just started that are expected to, with 11 patients and 5 patients, bring in about $45 million. So they're in survival mode, hoping that they can bring their lovo-cel therapy to market successfully as well. While you look at Vertex, and this is a slide from the Vertex deck, which talks about this opportunity for Exa-cel, and you see here they've identified 24 states with 90% of the sickle cell disease and beta thalassemia patients, and then they've identified the countries in Europe. They say here that they're engaged with Medicaid administrators in all 50 states about this coming therapy. So it seems like they're in a lot better position to make this a success than Bluebird Bio. Now, calculating the value that this will bring for CRISPR Therapeutics starts to get interesting. So you can do something like this. You look at the present value of future cash flows. There's certainly a lot of analysts out there doing this. You could say, well, 80% of patients will opt for a new therapy. Of those, 80% choose Exa-cel. Midpoint pricing of $1.7 million. Profit margin of 50%. CRISPR Therapeutics gets 40%, as we said before. So then you can start doing the math here. You see, well, CRISPR Therapeutics stands to bring in about $5.44 billion in profits. That's with the existing patient base. And then there's some sort of recurring revenue that comes from people who are diagnosed with these problems for the first time, right? That will continue. And of course, we looked earlier at a potential TAM expansion from changing the delivery mechanisms and such. But when you see articles, junk articles like this from The Motley Fool, more likely to five times first, Bluebird Bio versus CRISPR Therapeutics, don't expect that at all. So the idea here isn't that these companies are going to see that approval and that once the first patient is dosed, suddenly realize all this value. That's not how it works. We need to see how this progresses. And the big date that everybody's marking in their calendar probably will be a non-event, will be December 8th, 2023, when the priority review is hopefully granted for sickle cell disease. And then Exa-cel can start to be marketed. And then for the smaller addressable market for beta thalassemia, that date is March 30th of 2024. So CRISPR Therapeutics stock, may see some action. Certainly we've seen this before, gene editing. If you go back and look at the historical prices for gene editing stocks, they've gone crazy at some points in terms of hype. So remains to be seen whether or not that approval is priced in or the market suddenly acts shocked and that rising tide lifts all the boats. But the milestones that we're looking for here, that final approval to take place, so there's two events, December 8th and then March of next year. First patients get treated, revenues start ramping. Then we expect those to peak and establish some cadence. We'll be able to look at what Vertex says alongside what CRISPR Therapeutics says so we can get plenty of information from these events. And then the big question, what's next in CRISPR's pocket? Well, it's this CTX110. That's a topic for a different conversation. Now, when we think about other gene editing companies out there, notable ones like Beam Therapeutics, I find this to be rather confusing. Maybe somebody could shed some light on this. Why, if CRISPR Therapeutics is ready to launch this sickle cell disease therapy and they're already competing against one other provider, then why would the strategic priority, this restructuring for Beam Therapeutics, put their own sickle cell disease treatment in as a front runner alongside this other Beam 302 they're working on? That I don't understand, because it seems like CRISPR's already solved the problems. But the other company then to watch, of course, Intellia. Just a quick update there. So in October, they received a green light from the FDA to start their phase 3 trial for this compound. So this is the one that you watch closely to see how that's going. This will be the first late-stage test in the U.S. of a CRISPR-based therapy that works in vivo. That's editing genes inside the body rather than in cells extracted from patients. They expect to begin this study by the end of this year, and we'll see how that progresses. Now, from an investor's perspective, we like to look sometimes at what ARK Invest has invested in, just out of curiosity. You can see their genomics ETF here. CRISPR is the most heavily weighted there in their top five positions, and down the list you'll find Intellia and Beam, so they've invested in all three of those. CRISPR may soon be in the spotlight at the end of this year, provided that approval goes through. Expect that tide to lift all gene editing ships, so usually if a news event affects one company, then they all stand to benefit from that. And it may not affect CRISPR, in which case that tide may not lift all ships. Positive outcome seems to be fairly certain. So we'll see how much uncertainty was priced in later this year if the event happens. If it doesn't, then that's a different story. But Vertex appears to be taking the whole thing very seriously. You go to their investor deck and the first slide is all about this planned Exa-cel commercialization event. So we would expect a very quick ramp up just based on the language they're using. Following that approval, we can then monitor Vertex and CRISPR for information on how commercialization is progressing. So rather exciting times for CRISPR Therapeutics investors. Our next check-in will be when revenues start flowing for CRISPR. So I'm going to put up another video here that you might enjoy. Before you click that, please click the Nanalyze logo on the right, subscribe to this channel. Please like this video and help share it. That helps support us. We don't run ads. We need your help. Thanks for taking the time to watch us today.